This is a very unique and special moment. If you like music, and who doesn't, you are certainly going to be intrigued by this next guest. He is hailed for his work with some of the most iconic names in music, among them the Grateful Dead, Bob Dylan, Annie Lennox, the list can go on. It's a career that has spanned the past 5 decades. Now you see his face, and you know the name, Clive Davis. He is the chief creative officer of Sony Music Entertainment and the author of the New York Times bestseller, The Soundtrack of My Life. What a fitting title. And he's joining me now from New York. Mr. Davis, good to see you. Good morning.
Well, so nice to be here today.
So the artists that you've worked with range from Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, to Bruce Springsteen, and Whitney Houston. Yet early on, you had no interest in the music business. How did you turn your Harvard Law education, doing contracts, etc., to becoming the man whose name is synonymous with the music industry?
Just to correct the record, I had nothing to do with Jimi Hendrix. I'll lay claim to Springsteen and Joplin. You know, my parents died when I was a late teenager. I had no money to rise above the station. I studied law to become a lawyer. The fates were good. Luck was in my way, and the firm that I went to work for represented Columbia Records. I became their general counsel for 5 years, and then overnight, I was made head of the company. So I was thrust into it, and never knowing that I either had a natural ear and gift for music or that it would become the passion of my life.
So this natural ear for music and this real knack for, you know, discovering talent or recognizing talent, what do you suppose that quality is? And what is it that you look for when you tap into those kind of, you know, keen interests that you have?
Well, my first signing really showed it. You know, you hear about that tingle that goes up your spine. I saw the first artist, Janis Joplin and Big Brother and the Holding Company at the Monterey Pop Festival. It changed my life. If the word epiphany has any meaning, that's what happened. And I knew I had to step forward and make my first creative musical signing move. So that's what I did. And I signed Big Brother. She was so charismatic. She was a white soul sister that I had never seen. I don't think anybody had ever seen the likes of before, you know. And I trusted my ears after that as we launched Janis. And I was to sign Blood, Sweat, and Tears and Santana and Bruce Springsteen. And after a while, you know, you're looking for the headliner. You're looking for someone who can take an audience out of its seat. And if it's a singer-songwriter like Springsteen, who has become, with Bob Dylan, the musical poet laureates of America, you're looking for that incredible lyric, intent, depth, imagery to distinguish them. And so it's a combination, and it depends on the artist that you're really appraising.
So it was one thing, you know, a very big thing, to have that knack to be able to identify that musician, that artist has that it thing. And it's another for that artist to entrust their career in you. What was it that you either promised or what could you exude to those artists that they said, you know what, yep, sign me up. I want to be with you, Clive Davis.
Well, it was the first one that you have to cross that bridge. And there, I had a connection with Joplin, whether it was trust, whether it was integrity. We had an instant connection. But then when you start building that track record, and when you find that each of the artists, as I said, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and Santana, and Spring, when they start becoming successful, you start building your track record. You start building your expertise. And I do want to emphasize, I take none of this ever for granted to this day, so that I keep my ear fresh. I'm afraid of going over the hill. So I make sure peers of mine did go over the hill. I make sure that currently I listen to every new record as it hits the charts, mm-hmm. so that it takes, you know, vigilance And you build an expertise that the artist feels trust in you to give you the opportunity to work with them in their career.
So another artist who's very proud to attach her name to you, Aretha Franklin. You didn't necessarily discover her. She was already Aretha when your relationship began. But she did come to you because she felt like, and you write this in your book, she felt like she needed her career to be revived. What is it that you were able to do that, you know, you can be credited as helping Aretha?
Well, with Aretha, she's the greatest natural singing resource, you know, we've ever had in history. We always say put Aretha in one side. But artists need songs. If they don't write, the importance of signature songs to be a part of their career. So after Columbia, where I signed all self-contained rock artists that have gotten me in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, at Arista, when I founded Arista, I was honing my ear for the hit song and trying to see those entertainers who either didn't write or, like Barry Manilow, wrote but needed additional material for hits and signature songs. With the success of Barry, giving him Mandy and I write the songs, Can't Smile Without You, Weekend in New England, and then Dionne Warwick, I'll Never Love This Way Again, Deja Vu.
Oh my goodness.
It attracted Aretha. She wanted that creative partnership that she had with Jerry Wexler when she did Respect, a Natural Woman.
Unbelievable. Well, you know what, Clive, let me just stop you right there. When we look at the pictures of all the people that are associated with Clive Davis, there's still much more ahead with music legend Clive Davis. Just look at the names right there. Also missing on there is the picture of Whitney Houston, his very special relationship with the late superstar. We've got more on the other side of this break with Clive Davis. And the late superstar Whitney Houston singing the classic I Will Always Love You. We continue our conversation now with a man who helped discover her. Clive Davis helped shape her career, chief creative officer with Sony Music Entertainment and author of The Soundtrack of My Life, a bestseller. All right, you say this chapter about Whitney Houston really was one of the most difficult, maybe the most difficult for you to write. Why is that? Because of her death or because of the span of her career? The content of her life, what?
Well, the pain is still raw. You must understand, and for the record, I never worked with John Bon Jovi, but did with all the others. Regarding Whitney, I was there when her career began. I discovered her when she was 19, and we embarked on this odyssey, breaking every record in the record book. 7 number ones, 22 million with her first album. She was a workhorse. She went all over the world, you know, to break in every country. And it just continued. Bodyguard is still the best-selling soundtrack. So when you realize the magnitude of her talent, and I know her as a person, it was sad that, and tragic that she couldn't deal with the lethal issue of drugs. And so it's too recent, you know, to really, I did the best. I have an extended chapter in this book about A, our relationship, B, the sides of her the public did not know, and then, you know, the few days right before she died, what she was full of life looking forward to. So, yes, it's painful. We were more than just an artist that I signed in my administration. We were creative partners, and I worked with her to find every song she ever really recorded that's become a standard today.
I didn't know her, but hearing this song gives me chills. So I wonder, for someone such as yourself to know her so well, so intimately, to be so really ingrained in her life, what hearing her music, looking at these pictures, does to you?
You know, it rips your heart out is what it does, because she was full of life. And contrary to the tabloidal reports, I mean, she loved music. It was permeated her soul. When she and I were together, which was 48 hours before She passed away. She was playing me the music from her new movie, Sparkle. I was working with Jennifer Hudson. I was playing her the songs I was finding for Jennifer. So that whether in the industry, all of us, Babyface, Alicia Keys, those that wrote, produced, arranged for that glorious voice, we knew there was no one like her. And, you know, it is very, very painful that this tragic, tragic talent so prematurely came to an early demise, really.
Your book is beautiful because of the words that you speak. And then also, as soon as you open the book, that jacket, there's a photograph. And it is a remarkable photo. And I wonder the story behind this photo when you look at the talents of Alicia Keys, you, Rod Stewart, Carrie Underwood, you know, Pink. And then there is Whitney front and center. Where did this, what was the evolution of this picture? What was, you know, who had the wherewithal to take this photo when it was taken?
Every year I throw a party the night before the Grammys. We all celebrate music. It really has become the sought-after party each year. And a picture was taken for People magazine every year. It became a tradition. And that year, Alicia and Whitney, and there's Mark Ronson, there, you know, there's Leona Lewis and Rod Stewart and Carrie, they gather before the evening and we took this picture, and People gives us a two-page photo every single year. And that was the year, that's part of the book, I think that's the inside cover of my autobiography.
It's beautiful. Clive Davis, thank you so much for sharing your story, your life story, and that of so many other music legends. You are a legend. The soundtrack of my life, beautiful book. Thanks for your time. Pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And we'll be right back.